Amen and amen. Grace, you want to share? You want to share your testimony of your? Or you want us to do it for you? Joy, go for it.
Well, her sister has been having cancer trauma. And we've been praying for her on Wednesdays. And a while back ago, I just was real impressed to bring prayer cloths and pray for them.
Okay, no, wait a minute. The prayer cloth, the idea of the prayer cloth comes out of the book of Acts where Paul prayed over some cloths and passed, and they were sent out and people were healed by the prayer. There's nothing magical about the cloth. It's the faith. The prayer cloth is just a reminder of faith and healing. Go ahead.
Yeah. And so as Paul prayed on him, the anointing, you know, kind of was infused into the cloth. So we did that. We passed some out. And actually we gave one to a girl named Betty, who hasn't been here on Monday night, but she's been on Wednesday night. And she actually had a better report. Yes. But the awesome thing is, Colleen has been wearing her prayer cloth and been very grateful for our prayers. And it wasn't last week, it was the week before. And she was in the doctor's office having tests read. And Grace called me right away and she said, "Oh, it's so awesome, it's so awesome. The news is great that one of the tumors was gone. They couldn't find it. And the other tumor had shrunk like 60-70%. Yay.
Yes.
Yay. And I will share the other one too. Actually, she gave me two cloths because a friend of mine, her daughter.
Oh, about the baby.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, go ahead. Yeah.
Her daughter.
Forgot about that one.
Actually, I don't even know Vicki Roberts. Her daughter, Vicki's daughter, Ashley, has had cancer. Well, anyway, then she actually fell in love and got married, and they kind of were saying, you know, this isn't, you know, are you sure you want to go through with this marriage? Because, so they got married. Well, now they've been married, I don't know how long, not that long, and she so wanted a baby. She's been battling cancer and stuff, and the doctor said with all the chemo she's had and with all the radiation, highly unlikely she'd get pregnant. Number one, if she would get pregnant, highly unlikely she'd carry it. And the third thing was, if she would get that far, that the baby probably would be a normal child. So, took one of the cloths, and like on my way back home, like I stopped at Vicki's house and I said, "Okay, this is what we did," and I told her the whole story, and she's like got all teary-eyed, and she gave it to Ashley, and Ashley just had a beautiful baby boy.
Hey, come on now. See, that's just phenomenal. And see, that's exactly what we're going to be sharing. Does anybody else have anything else to share before anyway, anything else? Come on. Testimony time. And I remember Grace back in the early years when we were here.
So long ago.
And Grace went to a praise and worship night that we had up at the convention center. And make a long story short, she felt someone touch her in the back. You know, and she felt someone. I'm telling the story, you be quiet. She felt, actually, someone from across the room that we know went to her and says, "Can I pray for God?" And we know this person, and God spoke to this person and says, "You need to go pray for that lady." Didn't know, Grace. No, you don't, but we do. And she told us the story before you. I mean, she told us the other side of the story, how God spoke to her to go pray for you, and then you wouldn't let her pray for you. And the lady comes up to Grace. Grace has so much faith, you know. It shows you that God can is bigger than our faith even. You know what I'm saying? She asked Grace if she could pray for her back. And Grace, of course, back problems, you know, for ever since her problem at the post office with a bad driver. But anyway, and Grace said, "No." Yeah, that's okay. No one else was getting prayed for, so Grace didn't want to get prayed for. You know, in this little box, Grace, I'm sitting in this little Lutheran box that Grace has got in her head, you know. And so Ruth just stepped back, but she felt someone touch her. Grace, but thought Ruth went ahead and touched her, but Ruth never touched her.
I felt heat.
Yeah. And God just healed her of her back problem right there, despite her faith. God was going to heal you one way or the other. I tell you, took you out of the box, didn't it?
I thought she actually had something like a heating pad.
She never touched you. We know her. Isn't that something? That was God touching you. And we're going to talk about, yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
I noticed this last week that the plantar fasciitis in my left foot
gone.
Has been totally gone for the last couple of weeks. Like,
oh, hallelujah. Sometimes it comes quickly. Sometimes it comes, but, you know, just it's like the ringing in the ears. You get used to it. You know, like that pain in your foot. You get used to it, and all of a sudden it's gone. You don't realize, oh, huh, you know. But we're going to talk about that tonight. Yes, one more. Go ahead.
My dad has surgery this coming Thursday morning.
They Four.
Found a long 3.5-inch tumor growing on his left kidney.
Mm.
So they're going to remove a kidney.
What's his
on
name?
Thursday morning. Richard or Dick Wilkin.
Put him on the our new prayer request chalkboard. Dick Wilkin. Anybody else?
Even me, I'm having heart attack type symptoms again.
Don't we rebuke them? I'm not going to diminish or demise or say that that's not what's going on, which in Jesus' name it's not. I thought I was having a heart attack one time and it was just gas up here in the upper regions. I thought I was in pain. Yes, it does. That's why I thought I was having a heart attack. And found out it was just, yeah.
I've been there with that.
I've been doing some painting actually is what was happening, that the gas was in the upper regions of the lungs. And man, it was like hammer down bad. It was hurt. Okay, so
and just the kids, they enjoyed meeting everybody, and they had a great time. They worked hard and they played hard, and they just want to say thank you for your love.
Yep, amen. Okay, let me read you a scripture. It's in the book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 18. Matter of fact, it comes right after one of my most favorite scriptures, about verse 16. Talking about not being ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation for everyone who what? Believes. Verse 17 says, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. And as it was written, the just shall live by faith. If righteousness is not revealed, you will work for it. Until it's revealed in your heart. See, something happened in my heart. I was working for my righteousness. I was working for the faith. I went to Bible school. I was being a, you know, listen, when I was in the Marine Corps, the last thing I thought I was going to come out and to be in the Marine Corps was a preacher. Somehow preacher and Marine Corps just don't line up together. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I ended up, everything was works orientated. I was worried about my performance and all this, whether I did this right or that right or whatever. And then all of a sudden I got revelation of his righteousness through Christ Jesus. Not mine, his. In me. And when that revelation came, it changed my life. It changed my life. And again, if righteousness is not revealed, you will be a good church person always working for your righteousness, not feeling like you've ever done enough. Does that witness to anybody in here? Oh, I don't know if I've done enough. You haven't. I'm just going to answer the question. You haven't done enough. That's just it. And that's why you will always feel the way you feel until it is revealed. You will never feel like you've done enough. And there's lots of preachers out there who will remind you that you haven't done enough. And when that revelation comes, it will change your life forever. But that's not what we're going to talk about tonight. It's the next verse we're going to talk about. Oh, Romans chapter 1, verse 18. We just talked about 16 and 17. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all uncleanliness, ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Verse 19, because what may be known of God is manifested in them, for God has shown it to them. Listen to that. God shown himself to them. How? For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen. How's it seen? Say clearly. Clearly seen, being understood, just not seen, but understood. Not only can you see his attributes, but you can understand his attributes by the things that are made. Say creation. Even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. You can not only see God's character, his nature, but you can see the Godhead in the nature that he's created if you just look. Now, it didn't say the law, did it? It didn't say you were going to see his attributes in the law. It said in his nature. Even before the law came, people could see the attributes, the Godhead, the deity, and the nature of God in nature. God put his nature, when he created nature, he put his nature in nature. That's why we call it nature. It's God's nature. It's not Mother Earth. It's God's nature in nature and creation, okay? The reason I'm saying is that there's certain laws. Remember we talked about last couple weeks about the laws of the Old Covenant and the laws of the New Covenant, that there's a new set of laws under the New Covenant that supersede the laws of the Old Covenant. You don't mix them. One of the problems we have in churchdom, in American churchdom, is that we have New Covenant believers with Old Covenant mentalities. We get born again under a New Covenant set of rules and regulations, but live under the mindset of the Old Covenant. Because our church has mixed the old and the new together. That's why we're not seeing the things we need to be seeing in the New Covenant in faith. How many people have faith in God? Raise your hand. Everybody better raise their hand in here. We all have faith in God. But see, that's not the problem. Us having faith in God is not the problem. We're only using part of the law. The scripture says, now we've talked about the law of liberty. You know, there's the law of love. These are the laws that govern the new covenant. In other words, God said, here's a new covenant. Here's the laws to operate within the new covenant. Operate according to these laws. See, if you operate under the law of love, you'll never steal from your neighbor. See, it's not that you're trying to make these things. You're not living under these laws, but just living in that one, you're going to fulfill half the others. You see what I'm saying? If you love God with all your heart, you're not going to take his name in vain. See, the focus isn't on these 10, but within these two, the two great commandments. Love God with all your heart, neighbor as yourself. Those are two new covenant laws. Then there's the law of love, the law of liberty, the law of faith. I should say the law of faith in Christ's righteousness. And there are certain laws that have been in action that will always be. Has anybody known the law of seed, time, and fill in the blank for me when I pause, okay? Seed, time, and
harvest.
Has anybody heard of that before? See, the problem is with the church and the people of the church, we can believe in the seed, but we haven't believed in the harvest because we don't like the time. We don't want to put in the time to receive the harvest, but we really don't believe the harvest is really, we're not good enough for the harvest. And so do we actually even believe in the seed? But the scripture says this, believe and receive. How many of us believe? Raise your hand. See, having faith is not the problem. You know what the problem in the church is? The receiving part.
How do you explain speaking in tongues then? Where does that come from?
Okay, why don't we just stick on what we're talking about? And yeah.
Part of what you were talking about.
No. Well, we can get to that.
Okay,
it's by acting on it and doing it. See, speaking in tongues, you just open your mouth, and they come out. If you believe it, then you got to do something. You speak, and the tongues come out. You know, it's an action. It all goes back to believing and
receiving.
Believing and
receiving.
Sowing and
reaping.
Sowing and Believing and?
Receiving.
See, there's two parts to this. It's just not one part. You can believe in speaking in tongues, but if you never do it, you hadn't received it. People say, well, I can't receive it, or I can't do it unless I've received it. Well, that's part. Jesus told the person that was get up and
walk.
Could he walk?
Yeah.
Could he walk if he wouldn't have got up? See, he had to believe and then operate in. See, there's principles and laws. Let me finish, Joy, let me finish this, what I'm trying to get at. There's principles and laws are in nature that God has put there. Does every farmer around here that has crop plant seed in the ground? Does he give it time? I'm the worst person about giving it time. I want to see mine germinate the next morning. I'm out there next morning. I mean, I want to see them babies germinate. I don't like that time lapse in between planting and seeing it germinate. And that's not so bad. I don't mind waiting for the harvest. I just want to see that baby coming up, you know, because I know if it comes up, it's going to produce seed, time, and harvest. Did man make that law? God put that law in this earth. That is his nature. That's the way he works. Now, the way he works in the natural is the same way he works in the spiritual. Say spiritual.
Spiritual.
I didn't say religious. I said spiritual. He put his spiritual truth in nature so we can see it. Now, we have no problem putting in the seed and believing for the harvest and ready to receive it. I started buying cannon jars before I ever saw anything coming out of the ground. Why? Because I believed and that I'm going to receive the harvest in the natural. It's the same way in the super, the spiritual, the supernatural. It's you have to have just not faith, and we don't have a problem with having faith. We've heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. We believe that he died on the cross for our sin. And we receive what he's... And we believe that. Now let's receive that. Let me read you a scripture. Good to see you again.
I was just going to say real quick, when you're talking about acting on the faith, had Abraham and Sarah not acted on the faith, there wouldn't have been Isaac. They had to act on faith.
See, let me put this out there. Is that faith is what causes you to action. Authority is what determines your action and whether you do it. See, just like seed and believing and receiving, sowing and reaping, you have faith and authority. We, the church, has had faith, but the church has not operated in its authority. Our authority that we're supposed to be operating in is confession and walking out what you believe, putting labor behind your believing, you know, putting fruit, manifesting actions. Faith without works is on this earth. Let me clarify that. Faith without works is what?
Dead.
On this earth. In your Bibles, you need to clarify it and keep it straight. You need to put in there, faith without works on this earth is dead. Because in Romans chapter 4, verse 5, I wish you had it up on the screen, it says faith without works is righteousness. Oh, but we can quote, and we've done this before, we can quote faith without works is dead. Everybody quotes that. Why do we quote that one? Because we're looking in the flesh. The Bible says two things, faith without works is dead and faith without works is righteousness. Which one is it? Well, faith without works on this earth is dead, but in the realm of the Spirit, faith without works is righteousness. You don't need to show God your faith by your works. You need to show God your faith by your believing without your works. But, and James says, show me your faith. And then he turns around and says, I'll show you my faith by my works. In other words, faith on this earth is dead unless you have works to back it up. Those works we're talking about, whether they're the actions of your hands or the confession of your mouth, is a response of your authority. What kind of authority? See, you have authority in this, say in this earth. Have you been given authority?
Yes.
Yes. Is that authority for you to use in heaven?
No.
No. So where's that authority supposed to be used?
Right.
On earth. Are you going to need to heal the sick in heaven?
No.
Are you going to need to cast out demons in heaven?
No.
Where's the authority to cast out demons and heal the sick and raise the dead?
Right.
On earth. Where are we supposed to manifest God's word? In heaven? No. Or on earth. That's why Jesus said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth." So authority is for us on earth to manifest God's word. Your faith will cause you to action. Your authority will determine whether you, what action you take. And if you never take any action, you're not using any of your authority. And you'll never receive what God has for you. It doesn't mean that God hasn't already given you. See, in the old covenant, man did things and then God responded. That's why I tried to get to the very beginning. We have new covenant believers, old covenant mindsets. We're still trying to, well, I did it. Most people believe, okay, I'm going to do it and God's going to pour it out upon me. And you wait and you wait and you wait and God never pours it out upon you. Because He's already done everything that pertains to life and godliness. All the promises of God are what? Yes and amen. He's not going to do something He's already done. See, in the old covenant, that's the way it worked. You did it, He responded. In the new covenant, He's already done it, waiting for you to use your authority to declare it. Remember, you declare what He's decreed. You speak what He's already spoken. You speak what He's already established. If you don't speak, you don't receive. You might believe it, but you don't receive it. The biggest problem we have in the church is receiving what we believe, because we don't use our authority. We just sit back and wait for the world to dictate what happens to us, don't we? I mean, we're talking about other churches, other people, other realms, not us. We see, the church is not actively pursuing, walking in the authority of the believer. We are, we have been given. Jesus said, all authority, okay, back up. Genesis chapter 1. Okay, I just went through, I backed up from the new covenant all the way through the old covenant. That's what there was. God gave authority to Adam and Eve to do His will on earth. Not His will. Man's will. You call them what you name the animals what you want to name them. God gave man control of this authority. He gave him authority over this earth. Man fell, gave that authority over to Lucifer. Lucifer had the authority. That's why he was named, he was referred to as the God of this world. God wasn't the God of this world. See, we think that God is in control of. If you still have the mindset that God's in control of everything, you got the wrong mindset. Go ahead.
No, I'm just breathing.
You're what?
I'm just breathing.
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 Breathing. Oh,
yeah.
Sorry, sorry. God's.
You just said that God is not in control
of everything.
Of everything.
He's not in control of everything. Do you really think this is God's world? Do you really think God has children in Africa starving? Do you really think people are going unloved? See, God gave man control of this world. Jesus had to come back and go back in. When he said, before he ascended, the scripture said he descended. And what did he do? He took back the authority that was given. The first Adam gave it up and the second Adam had to take it back. And then he said, all authority has been given unto me, now I give it back unto you. We've been given the authority. We're the ones letting the things happen on this earth happen that happen on this earth, because we're not using our authority. Now, there is a sovereign plan of God that God's will be done. Sovereignly. There's a corporate, there's an eternal plan that God is sovereign with. Was it God's will for the children of Israel to go to the promised land?
Yes.
The first time?
Yes.
Did they?
No.
Ooh. God's will, it must have been God's will. Do you, okay, it's, It's God's will for you to live in sin then.
No.
No, it's not God's will, because you got a choice. See, God's will, God is not in control of every little thing that happens in your life. You are. God's not in control of you. You are in control of you. Turn to Proverbs chapter. Proverbs chapter 4.
You can back that up with Old Covenant stuff now.
No, don't have to. It's pretty easy. Proverbs chapter 4. It says this. Verse 20, my son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart. What are we supposed to keep in the midst of our heart? His word. What happens if you keep his word in your heart? For they are life to those who find them and health to all their flesh. What happens if you don't keep them in your heart? They won't produce life and they won't produce health. Keep your heart. Who's it telling to keep your heart? Who keeps your heart? God? Chapter 4, verse 23. Is God going to keep your heart? Who's keeping your heart? You are. Who's in charge of your heart? Who's supposed to renew your mind? You are. It says renew your mind. It says don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by what? So if you never renew your mind, you're still going to live with the stinking thinking you had before. That's why you have to read this word according to what this word says and just not hear what somebody's telling you it's saying. You're responsible for you. See, the church has the same problem that America has. America has become victim to being American. And the church has come victim to being churchdom. We've just surrendered. Well, okay, sirrah, sirrah. What will be. If that's the way you live, that's what you're going to get. But that's why the church is not doing what we're supposed to be walking in the authority. Faith and authority go hand in hand on earth.
Well, so were Adam and Eve.
Adam and Eve. And
they walked with God and they saw God and everything was right there.
Until.
Until they sinned.
Until they sinned.
Well, exactly. So I'm just saying, what choice do you have here on earth?
Our authority. See, they had authority.
Well, they didn't use it.
Right, but see, if we use it, if we don't use it,
he tells us from the moment we take a breath.
Who tells us that?
We're born into a sinful nature.
Yes, after Adam. But once we get born again, now we have a new nature with the authority. You don't have that authority until you're born again. Once you're born again, now you have an authority you didn't have before. But most of us have never changed our mind to the old way we were while we were yet before we were sinners. Now we have a new father, a new authority, a new destiny, a new purpose, a new reason for living. Now it's for us to take...
So people that have cancer and that claim it and don't be healed, how does that rock their faith?
God is never the issue. It is our understanding of the word that is the issue. Mm-hmm. Do things happen? Yes, things happen. But is faith about getting things to happen on earth the way we want them to?
Then why don't we just want to go to heaven now?
Exactly. Well, why don't we?
Why aren't people just taking themselves?
Why don't we just get saved and commit suicide?
That's what I'm asking.
Because that's not the purpose of God. The purpose of God is for us to bring heaven to earth. It's for us to be able to walk through these situations with people because we walk through them because we know who we are. We know that we are a son of the God our Father. We're supposed to walk through these things with people. Jesus came down to earth as a son to walk through these things with us to bring heaven to earth. We're the same thing. We're just like Jesus. We're supposed to have this authority.
Well, I witnessed it with my own father.
Yep.
He sang hymns to the end.
Yep.
He never once
said, absolutely,
I'm afraid of dying or whatever. We asked him if he's ready to see Jesus. Yes. That to me is his
beautiful
faith in action.
Beautiful. Beautiful. It was a beautiful thing. Have no problem. I got to witness it myself. It was beautiful. One of the most prettiest. The service, everything, the testimony of your family, beautiful.
Yeah.
Saw God everywhere.
And he was a man, though. He didn't, I think what different about him than other is that he just walked the walk. He didn't even have to talk it because people knew.
But he didn't have to talk. His actions were. He was a man of action. Don't ever think he wasn't a man of action.
Right, exactly.
He lived his faith.
Right.
And that's what we're talking. Most people don't live their faith. They just live the life that's been dealt with them. And whether he was the same all the way through, even when he had cancer.
Right.
And that's what we're talking about, is not letting the situations of this world affect the way what we believe in our heart. The greatest faith, we need to understand what faith is. Faith isn't about getting this world to bow to your knees. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Old Covenant, and the Book of Corinthians says this is what that these happened to these people in the past for our examples. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the greatest faith statement ever made, I believe, in the entire Bible. Whether my God delivers me from this fire or not, He's still my God. Oh, come on, church. That's having faith, and they didn't bow their knees to the situation. They stood in their faith, and they were ready to... You know why most people aren't raised from the dead? Because they don't want to come back.
Well,
do you? Once you experience heaven, you don't want to come back. You know, I mean, that's been a testimony time and time again, but faith is not about making your life easier, people. Faith is about you bringing heaven to earth in your life so you can bring heaven to earth in someone else's life when they're going through situations. We're supposed to raise people up in faith, not diminish their, oh yeah, cancer, oh my God. Are you building someone up in faith or are you sending them off to their deathbed? We're supposed to believe in God, whether we, blessed is he who believes without. I don't care how many people I pray for. If they never get healed, I don't care. I mean, it's not I don't care they get healed, but them not getting healed is not going to deter my faith in God as a healer. I'm not going to look back and say, well, the last guy I prayed for got sicker and died. That's not going to keep me from praying for people. You know why? Because my God's a healing God. He's never on trial. He's not on trial, people. We're the one he's been given authority to. He's gave us authority. Let me show you a scripture. One of our favorite scriptures that we go... Oh, let me finish reading this one. It says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of what? Your heart springs the issues of life. It's not out of God. You determine. Your life is determined by your heart, your condition of your heart. If you've got a sincere heart, you're going to have a sincere life. If you have a hard heart, if you have an evil heart, if you have a good heart... Your heart determines the person that you are. You don't determine your heart. Your heart determines you. Because that is the real you. Now watch this. As a matter of fact, in 2 Peter says, the hidden person of the heart. Look what it says in Romans. Everybody knows the book of Romans where it says, if you confess with your mouth, what? And believe in your... that God raised him from the dead, you shall be what? Well, verse 9 says, that was verse 9. Verse 10 says this. It says, for with the heart one believes unto what? To salvation. So you believe in your heart, you receive what?
Righteousness. You believe.
For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. Romans 10:10. It says this, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, does that mean that you can be righteous and go to heaven and never experience salvation? What is salvation, people? Salvation is not going to heaven. Look the word up. Go ahead. I know some of you have been told salvation is going to heaven all your life, but listen, just look it up in the vines or a Bible dictionary. Salvation is the word sozo. It means made whole, complete. It means healed, prospered. You're not going to need to be healed in heaven. Salvation is what you experience on earth of your right standing in heaven. If you never confess with your mouth what you believe in your heart, you won't ever experience it on earth. Confession's not going to do you any good in heaven. Turn with me to the book of James, chapter 1. And just because it hasn't worked for someone else doesn't determine my theology. The Bible dictates my theology. Too many people let life experience determine what they believe. James chapter 1. Did everybody just hear what I said? You can't let life experience of yours or somebody else's story determine God. You can't do it. If you do, you'll be tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. James chapter 1, it says this. James chapter 1, verse, I believe it's 8. Verse 7. For let... let's look at verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Does this saying have faith to get through the trial, to have the trials go away? It's not talking about this at all. See, most people heard the faith message as make your troubles go away. No, this is about you having faith to go through your troubles. Because that's what builds you stronger. I'll tell you what, look back at your life, the things that bothered you once before, you probably laugh at now. Man, there was times, I remember when I was first having kids, I used to let things all kinds of, when you're first having kids, you let all kinds of things bother you. Now you're, they'll get over it. Yeah, they'll get up. Don't worry about it, Mom. Oh, no, Mom's, You know what I'm saying? Because we grow in our experiences. Look what it says here. Now, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work. See, faith is about something happening in you, not on the outside of you. I guarantee you, those people that are looking at faith and making their life, you know, pink Cadillacs, they're not growing on the inside. You know, that's not what... Faith is about something happening on the inside. It says, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him... Now, we need to, again, understand what the word ask means. In our American mindset, asking comes from... is a word that is, we think, comes from a position of lack. If you don't have something, you have to ask for it to receive it, right? That's not what this is saying. This is speaking from a Middle Eastern mindset, and it's... let me just quote another scripture. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not... That word want is the same word as lack. This is not from a perspective of lacking. This is... Do you have the mind of Christ, the scripture says? You have the mind of Christ. So this asking is more of a declaration of thanking what you he's already done for you. Are the promises of God yes and amen? That means they're reality. Look what it says here. But let him ask in faith and not doubting, for he who doubts is like... In other words, do you doubt that you already have it? Well, I don't see it. Well, that's because you're looking in the flesh, not in the spirit. When Jesus took the loaves and fishes and fed the 5,000, what did he do with it? He blessed it. Now, how many times do we ask God to bless our food? Jesus didn't ask God to bless his food. Now someone's going to jump up and say, well, he was God. No, he was man then. As scripture says, he fixed his eyes. Read it. It's a beautiful story. He fixed his gaze or his eyes. He saw what they had, and it wasn't enough. He looked up and saw what was in heaven, and then he spoke to this as because of what he saw in heaven. He saw what the Father had, which was more than enough. How do we know it was more than enough? Because they had leftover. Jesus responded the way he saw things in heaven. That's why he said, the way it is in heaven, be on earth. He prayed that way and fed thousands of people and had leftover for them because he believed and received what was in heaven to meet the needs of the people here. Not his, but theirs. It's a beautiful scenario. We need to understand this. And let's go. Sure.
God's not Eden giver, he doesn't take it back. He came back to walk life just like we do. He had to depend and listen to Holy Spirit just like us so that he could be the example for us and that we could look to him, the author and finisher of our faith. And he came in flesh as a man so that he could be the imitation for us so that we could know, you know what? I can, depending on the Holy Spirit, just like Jesus had to depend on the Holy Spirit walking this planet, I can do the same thing. Because Jesus did it, I can do it. He lives in me.
See, my example is not somebody else's way that they've lived. My example is the way Jesus lived. Does everybody understand? The Apostle Paul even said it this way, follow me as I follow Christ. He just didn't say follow me the way I do it, because the way he said follow me because the way I'm doing it is the way I saw in the Spirit Christ doing it. Follow me as I follow Christ. Now watch what it says here in James as we go, verse 6, it says, but let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. Verse 7, let not the man suppose that he will receive anything of the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Now wait a minute, didn't we just talk about believing and receiving? But this verse says, if you're a double-minded man, you're unstable in all your ways and you won't receive anything from the Lord. Does that mean God's not going to give to a double-minded man? No, that's not what that means. The word there, receive, is lambono. It's a Greek word that means, basically, and I think we did this with Dan once when Dan was sitting on the front row. I'm not going to throw him a Bible. Now watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Greg, let her hold the Bible. Sit on your hands. Okay, do not reach out and catch this. Okay, now bend over, pick it up, and give it back to me. Okay, now catch it with your hands. Don't sit on your hands. Okay, see, that's the difference. See, a double-minded man is like a man sitting on his hands. Even though the Lord's already given everything that pertains to life and godliness, even though the promises of God are already yes and amen, a double-minded man cannot bring his life in line to receive what's already been established. See, God's, because these are laws in nature and they're laws in the Spirit, we have to come in line with the laws, the complete law, or we won't receive the benefit of the laws. Let me explain it this way. If you only do the sowing and never the reaping, you haven't received the benefit of the law. Faith without works on this earth is dead. There won't be any benefit to your faith. You're believing if you don't have works to back it up. No one will see what you're doing. Can people see your faith? Do they see what you believe? See, I believe God is doing a great thing in this area or we wouldn't have moved here. I believe God has spoken to my heart about why we're here. That's why we're building. Go look in the back. I believe this is going to take place. It's just going to happen. So I'm putting my faith, my works, to back up my faith because I believe it in my heart. And there, see, what's our faith saying? You see, what's our, Linda? Right.
You have too much, on the plate that you don't fall away either.
Yeah. We're talking about works for a different reason. Faith by works is different than works just being busy. Faith by works is you thinking that faith by works is
can I say this?
Sure. Yes.
It's I'm not working to do it. It's not an effort to do it. It's my natural response. It's because I so believe it. I so know it. And you only believe it and know that stuff by spending time hanging out with him. Yes.
There's things of this world.
That you got to do.
Yes. But this is the thing.
Sometimes Satan wants you to do that.
Yes,
right.
He does. He wants
to distract you from the other words. Yeah. See,
he wants to distract you. But the point is this. We have to have such an in-tune relationship. Like Jesus, he would go up to the mountain and spend time with Father.
To know what to do.
To know what to do and then come do it. And we have to have such an in-tune relationship with Holy Spirit that he can whisper in your ear, let them do this. And you'll hear him and you'll do that. When we have that kind of a relationship with Holy Spirit, that trust in him, we won't waste time doing the busy, stupid works.
We talked about this before, and again, we're talking about works. There's a difference in works, righteousness, and then just busy works. When a person believes that what they do makes them better to God, that's works righteousness. Okay, let me read you a scripture. We've talked about this before. It just makes, I can't believe it. Most people don't see this. This is in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. Therefore, leaving the discussions of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation, say foundation, of repentance from sin. Is that what it says?
Works.
It doesn't say repenting from sin. But how many people have heard the foundation of repenting from sin? Not saying we're not supposed to repent from sin, but repenting from sin is not a foundation. What's it say here? Not laying again the foundation of repentance from what? Dead works. What are dead works? Who's he speaking to in the book of Hebrews? Hebrews. It was the Jews that were doing things thinking that what they were doing was making them righteous. That is a dead work. Isn't that incredible? See, faith is not about you doing the works you do on this planet. Is comes from the authority that you have to do them with. Your faith, whether good or bad, right or wrong, you realize you have faith whether you believe in God or not? Condemnation. Has anybody felt condemned before? Yes? That is a response to the faith that you have in the law. If you've ever felt condemned or guilty, that means you have faith in the law that condemned you or the law that made you guilty. And so now you responded accordingly. Your faith and the authority. See, you have authority whether you apply it or not. It's happening. You felt guilty. You had faith in the law that made you feel, or you wouldn't have felt guilty. So you felt guilty because of the law. You had faith in the law. And so now you've done something or do something to try to make yourself pay the price for that. Your authority causes you to do something. Authority is what's missing in us, in the application of the right authority or the authority in the Word of God. We've been using our authority for what is natural, not what is spiritual.
So then, if I believe that I'm hearing something from the Lord, that He's saying something to me or giving me a word, if my acting upon it then is taking the authority that He's given me?
It's your faith. If you have faith in what God has said, your authority is now to respond in a certain way. Again, your faith causes you to action. Your authority determines your action. Whether you're believing in God or you're believing in the justice system or do you have faith in the doctor's report? It starts right there. Do you go, when the doctor tells you you have cancer, do you go, oh no, I'm going to die? Do you have a sinking feel? You have now placed because of that response shows you you've now given it authority. You believe that report more than you believe the report of the Lord. There's no fault, there's no wrong, there's no shame, there's no guilt. It has to do with what kind of life we're living. This is not about us having everything the way we want it. This is about us bringing heaven to earth so other people can experience it. And if we don't walk in the authority that God's given us, the people around us will never walk in the authority God's given them, at least in God's Word. People are walking in authority already. It's just they're having faith in the wrong things. We have to, the just shall live by what?
Faith.
Faith in God's Word. Faith in God's Son. Man, this is powerful. You got to understand, most of us have lived all of our life, all of us lived all our life in faith, but not in God's Word.
Can I just say too, like faith, your dad, he showed his faith and he operated in his authority. He had peace. You had peace through the whole
world. Oh, peace.
And that was faith in action. You had peace through that whole stormy ordeal.
And I'm going to say this, more than that, they had a confidence that they knew where he was going. See, authority, see, your attributes, confidence is the only way you can be confident is, your confidence is a display of authority of your faith. You walking in confidence in a situation shows that you're not moved by the situation, you're moved by, but you're way beyond this realm. When it comes to death, Christians don't die. We don't die. We'll never see death.
But if somebody tells you somebody died, you shouldn't go, yay.
Well, no. Well,
they're in heaven.
Hopefully they're in heaven. You know, you never know. No, but I mean, Joy can't wait. She can't wait to go to heaven. Well, I'm not going to call her back from the dead. When she died, I'm going to come back in Jesus' name because she'll slap me. No, quit it. No, no, never. Never. No. Condemnation never got rid of the sin in the first place. There's a difference in conviction and condemnation. Yes. The Holy Spirit brings conviction, not condemnation. And what we need to understand is faith that we... See, you have faith. How many people... You've heard a siren or something. You're not at home and you... You think it's your children or you think it's your house or who's in a wreck or... Oh, you hear a storm, tornado going through an area. You go, oh, no, my... You know, what are we applying our faith? Everybody's been given a measure of faith. What are we using it for, people? See, you can have faith in God... But are you using your authority now to walk in it? Are you acting like it? Are you responding to this world accordingly? Faith and authority go hand in hand. You can't see what God wants you to see. You can't live in what God wants you to live in on earth without the application of authority in your faith. Does everybody hear that? You can't let life dictate your theology. You must... Listen, how many people are saved in here? Raise your hand. You made a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. You know that He paid the price on Calvary for all your sins. And because of His righteousness, you're going to heaven, right? You're right standing with the Father. Wait a minute. You're telling me you can believe in a God you hadn't seen to go to a realm you've never seen before, to live a life you've never thought of ever living before for all eternity, and you can't believe for a pair of socks? Believe for a pair of socks. You can't believe for someone's healing. You can't believe for peace on earth in your heart despite the circumstances. You're telling me it's easier to believe in a God you've never seen, to go to a realm you've never been to before, to live for all eternity? And we can't believe for the kingdom of heaven on this earth? What's the kingdom of heaven on this earth? Apple pie and bluebell?
Amen.
Amen. No. No, Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. You can't believe for righteousness on this earth. You can't believe for peace and joy in your heart. The Bible says, let the peace of God rule your heart. God gave you control of this earth. What are we doing with it? If you really think that God is sovereign, see, God is sovereign. But in His sovereignty, He gave us control. He set in laws and put His attributes in nature, and He says, I will not go against my nature. He can't. Until the eternal plan comes, and there's going to be a day He says, that's it. Boom. The ends of time have come, and there's a new heaven, new earth. That's the sovereignty of God. But while we're on this earth and Jesus has not come back on the great white horse, you've been given authority. We're the ones responsible. I mean, mankind. We're the ones responsible for the starving children in Africa. Do they have food? Yes, they have food. They have gazillions pounds of food. Do they ever see it? No. Why? Because their government sells it. They're not starving because of people don't care. They're starving because of the greed of their own government. Their government's responsible for their situation, not America. Okay, people? Well, if God loved... No, God's proven His love. See, God's not going to send... Do you think God is going to make someone go to heaven? No. God has poured out His love by sending His Son. That's what the Bible says. He's proven His love already by sending His Son, making a way for all men, if they want to come to Him. God's not sending anybody to hell. They're sending themselves.
Can I just read these?
Yep.
Okay, so in all you ladies who have been to my John stuff, you know, this last little season has been my favorite season because John spent chapters 13 to chapter 17 preparing his disciples for the very difficult things to come. And this was one of the last things he said in John 16. He says, and in that day, talking about after he's risen from the dead, after the Holy Spirit has come and now lives inside of us to lead us and guide us, because he already talked about that. In that day, he said, you won't ask me anything. Most assuredly, I say to you that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until you've asked nothing in my name, ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. These things I've spoken to you in language that was figurative, but the time is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but I will tell you plainly about the Father. And in that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say that you will pray that I shall pray to the Father for you, for the Father himself loves you, because you love me, and I believe that I came forth from God, I came forth from the Father, and have come to the world again. And then, a little bit later, he said, indeed, the hour is coming, and now has come, that you will be scattered, each to his own. And he said, these things I've spoken to you, that you may have peace.
Mm.
He said, in the world, he's not promising pie in the sky. He said, in the world, you will
have troubles and tribulation.
But be of good cheer, I've overcome the world.
See, in you there can be peace, even though there's not peace in the world. It's that simple. Let me read this scripture to you. It says, Galatians chapter 6, verse 6, let him who has taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Now, you're not responsible for everything that comes into your life, but you're responsible for what comes into your life. If you sow kindness, you're going to receive kindness. If you sow love, you're going to receive love. If you sow friendship, you're going to receive what?
Friendship.
The scripture says, well, not, but you're still going to receive it. You keep on sowing. It may not be from the person you want it from. Ah! Say, that's what you're specifically targeting one person, but you're going to receive friendship. Okay? The scripture says, for him that wants a friend, may he first show himself what?
Friendly.
So you sow friendliness and receive friendliness. If you're kind and loving, people will know that and they'll be drawn to you. If you're a cantankerous old fart, can I say that in church?
Yes.
Are people going to be drawn to you?
No.
Why? Because you're sowing I don't like you seeds. And what's growing? A crop of I don't like you's back. What are we sowing? These are laws, people. I don't mean to say I don't care, but don't let life dictate your theology. Let theology dictate your life. Let God's Word dictate what you believe. I'll read this again. Let him who is taught the Word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows in the flesh will also reap, will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows of the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary. Here's the key phrase. Let us not grow weary while doing good. I can show you another scripture. It says in the book of Hebrews, it says, if you've grown weary, you've forgotten whose son you are. It says, if you've grown weary and discouraged in your soul, you've forgotten the exhortation that calls to you as sons. See, as we're doing what we're supposed to be doing, remember whose son you are. Remember whose child you are. Remember who's your daddy. As you're doing these things, and you won't grow weary and discouraged, because you're about your father's business, not your job. Jesus was about his father's business. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season, say due season, we will reap, see, seed, time, and harvest. These are God's principles. These are laws that God does not... I've said it this way for years, and the concept will not work, but in our little bitty minds, the way I've said it was, if God could go on vacation and quit being God for a period of time, people would still get healed, saved, delivered, crops would still grow. God put healing in your bodies. If you cut yourselves, guess what? It's going to grow back, and you won't even see the scars in years to come unless it's dramatic. But God put healing in your bodies to make you well. It's nature. The doctor doesn't make you well. The hospital doesn't make you well. God put his wellness in your body at creation. Sometimes there's that supernatural miracle that takes place where someone feels hands of heat on their back and they feel the pain go away. Thank you, Jesus. That's all I got to say for that. But God has put his nature in nature so we can experience and see. And if we just open our eyes, we can see these laws at first. Let me read the rest, all of this, because this is all part of the laws of God. And let us not grow weary and while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose
heart.
If you don't lose heart, what's it mean to lose heart? Where are we hiding God's word? In our
heart.
If you don't hide it there, you're going to lose heart. Not head, but heart. What do you believe in your... See, God is a heart God. And so many of us have made mental assent to Scripture and not heart implantation of Scripture. And I think I said it last week, 2 weeks ago. How do you know the difference between when Scripture's in your head and when it's in the heart? How do you... You may say one thing, but how do you know you believe it? That's a question many beady people ask. Real simple. When what you believe is when you feel it. If you feel it, you believe it. If you don't feel it, you best keep praying. You got to get in your heart. You best keep confessing. You best hang around people that believe what you want to believe. You need to believe it in your heart. God's word works in your heart. It doesn't work in your head. Okay? It works in your heart. There's lots of people that hear Scripture in their head, but God's word is in the heart. Let me go ahead and read the rest of this. It says, and let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially those who are in the household of faith. Man, this is powerful. We just get to understand what this is all about. Hebrews 11 is the Hebrews Hall of Fame of Faith, where this person did this and the great things. But at the end of Hebrews chapter 11, it starts off and says that the wives received their husbands back from the war and they were dead. Beheaded. People went through scourgings and beheadedness and all kinds of conflict because of their faith. But they still believed. See, faith isn't about making this world bow to your every need. Faith is about you going through this world as if you're of a different world. And you are. You're an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven on this earth. You're not of this world. You're a strange and peculiar person. Just look around. We're all strange. And we're all peculiar. Why? Because we come from a different world. It's called the kingdom of heaven. We represent this kingdom of heaven. This is our constitution and bylaws to a kingdom that supersede the Bill of Rights. It supersedes. Now, I fought for my country. Okay, I was in the Marine Corps for 4 years. I'll salute the flag. But it does. This kingdom, this my identity here supersedes my identity as a Marine. Once a Marine, always a Marine. Listen, once a son of God, always a son of God. Once he's my father, he's always my father. I see myself as one of his special children. I'm special, not handicapped, I'm special. I have the mind of Christ. No weapon formed against me to prosper. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives inside of me. This is my faith, and I'm going to act accordingly. What do we believe, and what authority do we use to back up what we believe? It will be through your actions, through your confession, or your confidence. It'll be through the joy and the peace in your heart. When troubled times come, you'll be strong on the inside. People say, hey, I want that. Why aren't you bothered by everything else? I know where my supply doesn't come from Walmart. You understand? My supply comes from the kingdom of heaven. I can look up into heaven and see what he has for me. And in time of need, it will manifest. I believe it.
Christ said, I always do what pleases the Father.
Oh. Always. See, so many of us, so many times Christians, we're saying one thing, but our lives don't come in line with what we're saying. It's called synchronicity. We have to, you know, we say one when our actions, because of our, so our actions, your actions are controlled by your authority. There's only one person in charge of your actions. Don't give me this Flip Wilson. Ah, the devil made me do it. No. The devil didn't make you do it. You did it because you wanted to do it. Right? How many people have done stupid things because stupid is what stupid does? Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. I was trying to save you on that one. One of the greatest quotes that's not in the Bible that should be, stupid is what stupid does. But it's really about the way you think and what's in your heart and what you believe. You know, you are responsible for you. Don't blame the devil and God for what's going on in your life. God's given you the authority. Either use it for his glory or use it for the flesh. The Bible said, we just read it, if you use your authority for the flesh, if you use it for spiritual things, everlasting life. Which authority? Where are you going to place your authority in the weeks to come? You going to use your authority for the things of the flesh, or are you going to use the things of the spirit? I choose. Now, that's why important is to understand spirit, soul, and what?
Body.
You got to understand spirit, soul, and body. If this little card, I know everybody has one. We're talking about spiritual truth realities. In the spirit, you're perfect. Are you perfect in the flesh? Say no real quickly.
No.
You're not. Despite what Dan says. He's not, no. But you're perfect in the spirit. What we're talking about tonight is spiritual truth realities. When you believe the way God says about you and what he says. See, the children of Israel didn't believe that God said what God, that they could have what God said, couldn't do what God said they could do, and couldn't be who God said they already were. So they didn't go into the promised land. But one day that generation died off, and another generation believed in what God said about where they could go, who they could be, and what they could have, and they believed it and they went in and took it. Their authority took them in. You know what happened during the 40 years the children of Israel were in the desert, in the wilderness, walking around and dying? Does anybody know what happened in the promised land? You know who wasn't there? The Philistines weren't in that land when they were supposed to go in it. During the 40 years there in the wilderness, the Philistines came in and inhabited the land. Who was the number one? Who gave the children of Israel more problems in biblical history? The Philistines. If they would have went in and took the land when they were supposed to, they wouldn't have the problem with the Philistines. What's that tell us about the way we're living? If we would go in and take what was ours to take with our authority when we're supposed to take it, we wouldn't have the problems to deal with in the future that we have to deal with. But because we don't take it and use our authority in the things that we're supposed to take it, things come into our life, and then we have to deal with them, but it's still our land, isn't it? It just makes life more difficult. And they eventually went in, kicked out the Philistine, kicked out all the Anaanites and Canaanites and Mennonites and termites and all these other things. Did I say Mennonites? I just threw that one in for Jim's sake. Womenites, and Manites.
Jesus made a comment that to me is really a powerful comment. He said, the ruler of this world has come, and he's found nothing yet. Because he'll come, the enemy tries to come and trick us up and deceive us and distract us. But there was nothing that Jesus hadn't given him any place, in any room.
Again, I'm going to say this out loud again and again, but if you have the mindset that everything in this world that happens because of God wanting it to, you don't know God. I'm just going to leave it at that. And you need to ask God to forgive you for thinking He's letting this happen. But people aren't. And He did what He did so everyone could. But it all goes back to individual's authority. Then it goes back to family authority. Then it goes back to church authority. Then it goes back to nation authority. These are all different levels of authority. And our nation has lost that authority. Then you can see what's happening. It all starts with the individual. God's not doing it. Man is. And the further we get away from God's authority, the worse it's going to get. And the Bible tells us it's going to get worse, not better, people. Yeah. But on the inside is where it's going to get better. It's not going to get better on the outside. You can pray for America all you want to. I'm not being rude here. But you need to be praying for what's going on inside of you. To be strong when America does go through what it goes through. We're the ones that need to rise up and shine in the darkness. You know, a little candle, you light a little flashlight, a little candle in the daylight, it's no big deal. You light that candle in darkness, and that's when it's most effective. Guess what? We're fixing to become effective, people. The question is, can we shine? Can we shine in the midst of darkness? We're going to find out. Inside.
So bright that the world is going to go, oh my gosh, I need that.
I tell you, there's such a powerful truth. You know, again, this is spiritual truth reality. We need to know who we are. We're seated in heaven. The book of Ephesians is full of it. Chapters 1, 2, and 3 is all about being seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Before you can cast out demons, it's in the last part of the book. It talks about how to be a good husband, good wife, good employer, a good deacon, a good elder, a good pastor. Before it talks about that, it talks about being seated in Christ. Being seated in Christ. What are you doing right now? You're seated in a chair. You're conformed to the image. You're in the same shape of the chair. You're seated in the chair. You're seated in Christ. Just the spiritual, again, natural things. Spiritual. You're seated. You're in the same shape as Jesus Christ in heavenly places, far above. How far? Far above principalities and powers. Are we? Spiritually, yes. Physically, no. We got to live according to this. We got to see this, confess this, use our authority to act upon our faith about this. If you don't believe you're seated in heavenly places, you'll never have the authority on earth. Question, do you pray for people when they're sick? If you don't, you don't believe that God's a healing God. And that's okay. Just go ahead and be sick. I'm not being rude. No, I'm not being rude. Don't say I'm being rude. But if you don't want it, you don't believe it. There's people that don't believe in the Holy Spirit. That's fine. Let them. You're going to go to heaven without. That's fine. You just won't be effective on this earth as you could be with the empowerment of the Holy Ghost. That's what the Bible says. Doesn't mean you're not, that you're better or worse or nothing. Just means you won't receive it. Believe it and receive it. The things of God. If you don't want it, you don't have to receive it. If you don't want salvation, I'm not going to force you. I'm not going to beg you to get saved. Be right with God. It's your choice. But there's an authority that you have, already have. I'm trying to encourage you to use that authority for the Word of God in your life so you can shine in the midst of darkness, because that's going to make the difference. That's going to determine, that's why the Scripture says that He'd rather be hot or cold, not this lukewarm in-between stuff. There's going to be a time, I'm telling you, church, I may not be your pastor per se as far as the church you go to on Sunday morning, but I'm telling you, as a pastor, it's time to start getting hot for God. A what?
A seed.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Some plant, some water, but who's responsible for the increase? God.
Somebody's got to plant.
Got to plant. That's right.
And
but
just be obedient to that
moment. Now's not the time to be lukewarm, church. Now's the time to rise up and shine. Better practice now, because it's going to get darker, not lighter. The Bible even warns about the time when the righteous are accused of being guilty.
The wrong shall be made to seem right.
You got it. You got it.
That's what's happening, right?
Sure it is. That's what the Bible says.
Say that again. They're accused of being guilty?
Yeah. When you're right, when you're righteous, you're wrong. In other words, when you're godly, well, you're wrong. See, we believe in husband, wife, male-female marriages. Well, we're wrong now. We're wrong if we believe that. You're a homophobe.
It happened in the 70s. It started there. You're bad.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm just saying. When they took prayer out of the schools, when it all began to flip, when it left the educational systems, when America began to turn. Well, I do disagree a little bit, because he does honor those that elected him to serve. That shows you well, America elected him in twice.
Yes.
Once by accident, second time they did it on purpose, and
yeah.
America's getting what they elected. That shows you the condition of America, not our president.
Well, that's true.
He didn't get in there without votes.
It was his condition.
You didn't, but America did.
Right, exactly. Yes.
Yeah, but they listened to him.
The world. But see, but now the world is saying, they didn't have the eyes to see.
Right.
Know.
Sure they did.
This man was not
sure.
Something that was going to be good.
And they don't want, they listen, a lot of people love him.
I know they do. I can't
remember. And more than half America love him and what he's doing.
I know.
But see, we're the minority. So it's not, again, God is sovereign, and in his sovereignty he gave man authority to rule this earth. Man gave it over to Lucifer. Jesus came back, took back the authority, and gave it back to man, and gave us the authority. The question is, are we going to use it for his glory, or use it like for the flesh? We have authority to back up our faith. Most church people have faith, and they're not applying their authority. And they'll never experience their faith until they get to heaven someday. Jesus came, he said this, "Our Father who art in heaven," everybody say it with me, "hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Man. Jesus came to establish on earth what was already in heaven, and used his authority to back up his faith. Enjoy.
And I'll attach it to a picture.
It's okay. So, I just want everybody to understand that, listen, I'm not a end of time scenario, end of, you know, I'm just saying, time, listen, we need, it's time for you to start using your authority to back up the faith that you have. If you don't use your authority to back up the faith you have, you're not operating within the laws that govern this earth. You'll go to heaven. You'll,
along that line, you know how, you know, the whole before in the beginning that Curtis likes to share a lot, which is so powerful. Each one of us here, God could have chosen us at any point in the timeline of history. But he chose each one of us for now. And he's equipped us to be here now. And he's anointed and appointed us to be here now, so that we can shine that light. And so he has within each one of us the power and the authority to walk and to share his light and to be his authority now. And so it's an exciting thing. He's invested a lot in each one of us, and he's invested all of history, because for us to walk in what we are called to walk in here and now took all of history to back us up.
And to think how, women, how they're getting treated by the ISIS is, and all they can think about when they get up in the morning is how they want to kill themselves, because they don't want to live that way. And if they do kill themselves, they feed that woman to the dogs. So think, okay, we're here. How do you think we're in that place?
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity you've given us to gather together. We celebrate your wisdom and your logic. I thank you for your word that's being made manifest in our hearts. Holy Spirit, you are the great teacher. And I thank you for revelation knowledge. I thank you for your word that stands true. Father, I thank you that we are being transformed when we look into the mirror and see ourselves the way you see us. We choose to see ourselves the way you see us, as sons and daughters of yours. In Jesus' name, amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song. Deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have come. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no mother's womb, you have chosen.